Hello, this video is an introduction to analog to digital converters with Raspberry Pi, specifically two chips that are sold in electronics kits on Amazon and eBay by Freenov, PCF 8591 and ADS 7830. Raspberry Pi does not have analog inputs, therefore you need chips like that if you want to use components such as potentiometers, thermistors, and photoresistors. Analog to digital conversion is a process of determining a numerical value representing voltage. Each ADC chip has a resolution measured in bits. For example, 8-bit converters such as the ones featured in this video are capable of distinguishing 2 to the 8th power possible levels of voltage, which is equal to 256. Starting at 0, this makes the maximum value 255. When you buy a Freenov Raspberry Pi kit today, it will most likely come with the ADS7830 chip. Older kits featured the PCF 8591 chip. Both chips perform the same function, but the newer one has twice the number of inputs, 8, and it is much easier to connect on a breadboard. There are some differences between these chips in the way they are addressed in code, although they both use the I2C protocol. I will provide the necessary information for both chips in this video. Let's have a look at the schematic diagrams showing how to connect a potentiometer to both chips. I will use a potentiometer as a controller to control brightness of an LED using pulse width modulation. Here's a breadboard with the newer ADS7830 chip installed following the diagram shown. This circuit is very easy to put together. The converter only needs 3.3 volt power, ground, and two data connections for the I2C protocol, SDA and SCL. The data connections are connected to the Pi pins with the same names. I use the analog input 0, which is connected to the middle pin of the potentiometer. The other potentiometer pins are connected to the ground on the left, and 3.3 volts on the right. With the potentiometer connected like this, turning the shaft counterclockwise changes the digital value towards 0, while turning it clockwise, the value changes towards 255. You can reverse these connections for the opposite effect. In case you're unfamiliar with potentiometers, they are three terminal resistors. In this particular case, where the edge pins are connected to power, ground, and 3.3 volts, for example, with the middle pin used as a reference point, the potentiometer is a variable voltage divider. The middle pin voltage will vary between 0 and 3.3 volts, depending on the rotational position. The ADC chip will take that reference voltage and convert it to a numerical value ranging from 0 for 0 volt and 255 for 3.3 volts. Potentiometers come in different resistances, shapes, and sizes. Here's another potentiometer with the same parameters and functionality, but in a more compact package. For this project, the resistance of the potentiometer does not matter, minus 10 kiloohms. Make sure to double check your circuit, especially if you use the older PCF 8591 chip with the more complex wiring requirements. You can check whether your Pi recognizes your chip using the I2C detect command. If you get an error such as this one, you need to enable the I2C protocol using the Raspi config before proceeding with your program. The Raspi config utility is navigated using keyboard arrows, tab, and the enter key. Look for I2C in their interfacing options and enable it. I2C protocol supports multiple devices on the same bus, as long as each device has a unique address. The default address for the ADS7830 chip is hexadecimal 4B. I will briefly connect another breadboard with the PCF 8591 chip, where you will see that the default address there is hexadecimal 48. With these addresses being different, I could use both of the chips on the same breadboard and have a total of 12 analog inputs that way. In any case, you need to know your chip's address as this number is used in code. Let me reconnect the ADS7830 chip and write a simple test program, which will print the potentiometer value to the terminal and set the LED brightness. This is a skeleton program I usually start with. The SMBus library is a simple interface to the I2C protocol, and it works well with both FreeNode chips. The GPIO0 library PWM LED will provide me with dimmable LED functionality. That is all for the basic setup. Don't forget to explicitly close the LED when the program exits. I need to write three functions, one for each ADC chip to read its value, and a third function to handle the terminal output and the LED. The PCF8591 is read using two I2C commands. The first command prepares the chip, referred by its numerical address 48, letting it know which analog input will be used using a numerical command. The inputs range from 0 to 3. The second command reads the value. This function will provide the numerical reading from the analog input every time it's called. The ADS7830 is slightly more complicated, but I will also put it in a function which will result in the same outcome in the end. With 8 analog inputs, the chip accepts 8 different commands. However, unlike with the first chip, the commands are not consecutive numbers, which were easy to calculate, so I need to put them in a list. With the command list in place, the rest is very similar to the PCF8591 chip. The command list will be used to look up the appropriate command. I use hexadecimal numbers throughout these two functions to keep it consistent with the output of the I2C detect command. You know which chip you have. Use the function appropriate for your situation in your program. Now I will write an additional function which will continuously read the ADC chip and display that number in the terminal 20 times a second. I will use the ADS7830 function which matches my breadboard connected. The LED brightness is set using its value property. As the acceptor values range between 0 and 1, I need to divide the ADC reading by 255, which is the largest number that can be produced by the chip. The last thing to do is calling the values function when the program starts. The program is ready to be tested. All I need to do is set the permissions and I can run it. You can see the numbers changing as I rotate the potentiometer shaft and the LED brightness following. Depending on the quality of the potentiometer, the value received may not reach 0 or 255. There's also a possibility of jitter, small value fluctuation due to the quality of the ADC chip and stability of the power supply. Any flickering you may see is just limitations of the video recording. However, the LED does not dim very well, especially on the lower end using straight pulse width modulation signal, as implemented by the PWM LED class. Making it look better requires rather complicated math to compensate for that. I have an entire video on this topic if you are interested, but here's the minimal code for that. With the compensating code in place, the LED adjustment looks much better. You can experiment with it to see how it works exactly if you choose to make such setup yourself. The program has one flaw, the while loop. I could not easily add additional components to the breadboard and expand the program. I typically put infinite loops in a thread to alleviate that, but this time I will use an advanced feature available for the GPIO0 classes such as PWM LED. GPIO0 objects have their own internal thread which can automatically process a list of values such as those produced by my while loop. The source property needs a generator function that will provide such values. By default, the generator function is called every 0.01 seconds, but that can be adjusted to your needs using the source delay property. If you are unfamiliar with the generator concept, a generator is a function that continuously produces values. Typically, a generator will have a loop inside, but unlike a regular function which uses the return statement, a generator uses a yield statement. The yield statement returns the generator value and pauses the loop execution. Next time the generator function is called, the generator resumes where it left off, returns the next value, and pauses the loop again, and so on. There is no reason to slow down the generator, so the sleep statement will be taken out. The only change required to make my values function a generator is the introduction of the yield statement in the right spot. As my testing is concluded, I will also remove the print statement from the generator. Of course, you can leave it in if you like. The updated program will work as before, but now I can add additional features as the while loop no longer blocks the main program thread. The pause statement is now required. It was not really needed until now. Without the pause, the updated program would end as soon as it started. This is the end of this tutorial. If you found it interesting, you might want to check out my advanced LED pattern blinking video. You can add an ADC chip to that project and use potentiometers to adjust the pattern speed and LED brightness. Thanks for watching.